Father Sergeant's talk, so mine is a little low-key talk, but a very important message on this important day for us, which is the World Hepatitis Day, which is today. It is one of the 9 approved days, health days by the WHO, not because hepatitis is great, it's because of the numbers involved in the world. So as you can see, it affects 325 million people worldwide, causing a lot of deaths every year, and especially in India and Asian countries, the incidence is much more. I was surprised to find out that as per WHO records, the second major infectious disease is death in the world after TB. So it's pretty common, particularly in Asian countries, more in the Southeast Asian countries. And the irony and the importance of today's message is that this is completely preventable. It is not something you cannot avoid, especially hepatitis B. And now hepatitis C is completely curable. So we don't need these numbers. We can make it even zero over a period of time. And that is the aim of this World Hepatitis Day, which is now accepted by WHO as an important aspect to spread awareness. And also these numbers, which Dr. Balaji mentioned briefly, that we talk about high-tech technology, but 80% of people who live with this disease don't have access even for diagnosis and simple treatments. And luckily now, the governments of various states have taken it upon themselves. There is a National Hepatitis Council being set up to take this on really head-on and try and eradicate this in India with the government aid. Again, the other alarming factors, out of this 325 million, probably 8 or 9 in 10, 80 to 90% may not even know they have the virus. Because as you all know, hepatitis B and C is a silent disease. Not just in the early stage, but even in the middle stage. Only in the late stages when the liver gets completely damaged, patient has cirrhosis, then the symptoms start manifesting. So it is something that people don't know they have and they may be silently dying inside. So WHO has set a very ambitious target, this was in 2018, that by 2020 we need at least 30% of all the cases across the world diagnosed and hopefully eliminate this by 2030. It is ambitious, maybe we will achieve it by 2040, 2050, but the ball has started rolling. So we need a massive increase in screening, diagnosis and linkage to care for those who have active disease. And this is the reason why people who are treating hepatitis do these talks to increase awareness. I'm sure most of you know. But the statistics are important so that you understand how big the problem is. So today's talk is just an overview of where we are in the roadmap of hepatitis B and C over the last 40, 50 years. And in 2019, how we manage these diseases. As far as B is concerned, in India, the prevalence is between 2 to 7%. Comes under intermediate. In non-tribal areas, the incidence is slightly lower, 2.4%, but pretty high in tribal areas because of the practices they perform, living in clusters. They use a lot of needles in their religious and social cultural practices. So this is the reason why. And in some areas, IV drug use is common, like Northeast Punjab. So wherever these needles are being used freely in the community, naturally the risk of needle-borne infections are higher. So in tribal areas, it is pretty high. So as you all know, there are 3 main modes of transmission. It's important to go through them because we can see how we can eliminate this pretty easily. This is true for both hepatitis B and C. Thankfully, percutaneous parenteral transmission has come down significantly. These were traditionally through blood transfusions and reuse of needles and etc. So now almost everything which is sharp is single use, and I think most health centers, hospitals are following this. But still we hear about outbreaks in hospitals of hepatitis C, hepatitis B, HIV, etc. So these things need to be constantly monitored and tightened so that it can never happen in a healthcare setting. What is important is this, contact transmission that comes through instruments which you cannot throw away. For endoscopy, for example. The endoscopy enters the tissue. There is some blood and tissue which are involved in the endoscope. There are small opening suction devices, channels in the endoscope. where these blood and secretions may enter. And if the endoscope is not handled or sterilized properly, then that is a mode of transmission. And this is true for many instruments. Whether surgical instruments are now less invasive procedures, we are talking about less invasive procedures, all these instruments have the potential to be reused, and if they are reused in an incorrect way, then you can spread infections, not just these infections, but even TB, bacteria, fungus, etc. So this is an area where every healthcare facility should be extremely sensitive to and make sure that each instrument has a way of dealing with it. Like we have a protocol for endoscopy, and we have to follow those principles. And finally, maternal to child, again, this used to be a huge problem, and in fact, the largest way of transmitting hepatitis B in India used to be maternal to fetal. Again, drastically coming down simply by checking the mother for hepatitis B. Every pregnant lady is now checked, I think, almost always. And then you can take adequate precaution by giving immunoglobulin to the child and vaccination. Almost 99 to 100% of the time you can avoid a transfer from mother to child. So these are simple things we can do as healthcare workers, as doctors, owners of hospitals, nursing homes, and it's important to remember them. So when you get hepatitis B exposure, you get an acute infection which may be clinical or subclinical. In children, 90% of these acute B will progress to chronic B. In adults, the reverse happens. 90 to 95% of the time, we are able to clear the virus. Sometimes we don't even know we got it, and we clear it, and we have antibodies formed later. But around 5% of adults who are exposed to the virus can develop chronic infection. So this chronic infection is a problem because it remains in various stages in the body, and it gives rise to three major problems: cirrhosis, liver cancer, and liver failure. And it used to be death sentence for many patients. Now we have this interim treatment called liver transplant, which saves many of these patients' lives. Again, like all technologies, like all new treatments, it's extremely expensive. And only a few in the country are able to access this. And this again has to grow because there are still a lot, even though we may prevent hepatitis B by 2030, 2040, there's still a huge amount of patients who already have liver damage. And we have to find a way out for them. Sometimes it is not possible to reverse this cirrhosis or cure them, and a lot of them may need transplant. So I just want you to know this slide so that you understand how the virus behaves in the body and how treatment can be directed accordingly. After it enters the body, there is a period called immune dormance, which happens mainly in younger people, children mainly, where the immune system is not fully developed. So it simply observes the virus, it doesn't react to it. Called immune tolerance, where you have a very, very high DNA level, but there is no SGPT elevation or liver injury. After some time, the immune system wants to get rid of the virus. There is an interplay between the receptors and the viral antigens. And while it's trying to kill the virus, this is when the liver damage happens. The virus actually lives inside the liver cells. So whatever the immune system does will affect the liver cells, cause inflammation, necrosis, and eventually fibrosis. So during this clearance phase is when the actual damage happens. The body may be able to get rid of the virus and the patient may become negative, or the immune system will suppress the virus activity and they go into this phase called carrier. We don't use that term anymore. We call it either HBV infection or low replicative state. And this carrier, we used to think, is the end of the matter. They will remain like that the whole lives, but no. At later stages, usually in the 40s and 50s, it can reactivate, sometimes silently, sometimes very aggressively, causing early death. It's called acute on chronic liver failure. And this phase is the phase where most patients get problems. They get cancer, they get liver failure, they get acute decompensation, and this is an area of concern for us. Sometimes we can reverse it, sometimes they need urgent transplant, or they will die. So we know that this phase exists, so we cannot ignore this carrier. At later stage they may develop, so we simply ask them to come under follow-up, keep monitoring. And again, an important aspect of hepatitis B, many people may not know, is that any stage of the disease, whether it's immune tolerance, carrier, or active disease, they can develop HCC. So HCC is a common complication of hepatitis B. And now WHO has listed hepatitis B as a carcinogen because of the high incidence of HCC that occurs in these patients. So once we diagnose hepatitis B, in a simple way we look at three aspects. One is to see how the liver is. For this we rely on liver function tests like ALT. Nowadays we are doing fibrosis assessment. We use FibroScan. There are other modalities like ultrasound based techniques. We need to know the viral status and activity. We do the E antigen. And most important test is the DNA. This is the actual measure of the viral particles found in the blood. And you get a value, a quantitative value starting from 10 going up to crores. I've seen 100 crores also in some patients. And this is done by the PCR technique. And we always screen for HCC using simple techniques like ultrasound, alpha fetal protein. If there is any doubt thrown up by this, we do CT or MRI. The reason for that is HCC also is curable if picked up early. Within a certain size, Dr. Neela Megham can resect it. If it grows beyond that, we can even do transplant for it. And there are a lot of radiological techniques to arrest the spread of HCC. So if caught early, it is an eminently treatable cancer. So the goal of treatment is to prevent the progression to cirrhosis, liver failure, HCC, and maintain the DNA at the lowest possible level. So as of today, we cannot remove the virus by any medication or injection or any other technique. But by doing this, we can prevent death and transplantation for the patient. But for this, we need to diagnose the patient at a fairly early stage. And it has been shown by this beautiful study which was published in the mid-2000 called the REVEAL study that if the DNA value is less than 2000, the chances of progression of cirrhosis is much lower, and as the DNA increases, the chances of cirrhosis and liver failure keeps increasing. So the target is 2000. And statistics for HCC, that if you keep the virus below 2000, the incidence of HCC is very low. As it keeps increasing, HCC keeps increasing. So 2000 has become our target for treatment after this study. And treatment has gone through the 90s when interferon was tried very unsuccessfully. And then the first oral drug came in 98. So now we have this new drug for BAF. So these are all the oral drugs available. Now we preferentially use entecavir and TAF as the two main drugs for hepatitis suppression. And this is why, because you have two types of hepatitis B, E positive, E negative. This is a 1 year data of how much DNA is suppressed by giving these oral drugs. In E positive, these two main drugs that we use, around 75% of the time we are able to suppress virus. This increases to 90 to 95% after 3 to 5 years. In E negative virus, in 1 year, by 90 to 93% of patients, virus is suppressed. Suppressed means very low level, usually below 300 IU. And like I mentioned, if it goes below 2000, that patient is fairly safe. And by 5 years, almost 100%. So 95 to 100% of the time, over a 3 to 5 year period, we're able to suppress the DNA to a very low level, thus protect the patient from liver failure and HCC with the drugs we currently have. And luckily, all the old drugs were developing resistant, just like the HIV drugs. But these two, entecavir and TAF, do not show much resistance, maybe less than 1%, and even that may not be a true resistance, maybe intermittent therapy. So hardly any resistance with a good long-term effect. So it's a wonderful drug that we have now. And for the first time in 2013, it was shown after hepatitis B effective treatment for 5 years that cirrhosis can actually reverse. And it was so convincing that the Boyd textbook of hepatology has actually changed the wording that cirrhosis is irreversible to cirrhosis can regress in certain conditions. They changed the word for the first time after 50, 60 years. We always learned cirrhosis is irreversible, but with these modern treatments, it is becoming irreversible, but it doesn't happen to everyone. And the really bad cirrhosis where the liver shrunken and portal hypertension is not going to reverse. At an early stage of cirrhosis, before remodeling occurs, it is possible to regress. So in a small percentage, it may regress. If you look at regression partially, 74%, and even the thickness of the fibrosis has been shown to be reduced. So this is the future. The idea is to get rid of the virus completely from the body. The difficulty with hepatitis B is the hepatitis B genome, called cccc DNA, gets integrated into the hepatocyte. It kind of just goes into it. So that's why you cannot remove it that easily. And within the hepatocyte, it replicates when the environment is right. So we can target the entry into the cell. We can target the release of viral particles from the cell. This is a kind of promising, is the immune modulation. You modulate the defective T cell, which is not able to kill the virus, to kill it better. And inside the liver, since the entire cycle has been analyzed and all the key molecules have been identified, now the pharma's research is to target these molecules, see if we can block them, and by blocking them, can we prevent this from activating or even get rid of it. So the next 5 to 10 years, this is the research. So maybe in 10 years, if we have a talk, it will be quite different from today. C is a more happy story because we can cure C now. India comes under 1 to 2.5% of population having C. So many times we do the screening test, which is HCV antibody. Antibody shows exposure to virus. To confirm the virus is actually present, you need RNA, which is again a PCR based technique. If it is found, then the patient has current infection. And like B, C can also cause chronic hepatitis, fibrosis, cirrhosis, cancer. Unlike B, 80% of patients who develop hepatitis C become chronic hepatitis C. In B is only 5%. So almost all patients who develop hepatitis C will become chronic, which will stay in the body and blood for many years and gradually destroy the liver. So C is nothing much to say because we can easily cure it. If you find C in 3 months, you can cure it. Again, it started in 90s with interferon, and most of the time we struggled with this. For the last 10 years of my practice, we were struggling with this. We used to use pegylated interferon and ribavirin combination for between 6 to 12 months with a 50% success rate. Very expensive drug, lot of side effects, patient really struggled, spent a lot of money, and half of them may not clear the virus at the end of it. So it's a huge disappointment when they're not able to clear, and tough for me to face the patient, tough for us to face the patient. And then we started getting good oral drugs, and now we have an all oral therapy with a 95% plus cure rate in a simple single pill. And the reason is this: the viral genome has been identified, and the key pathways which allow the virus to replicate itself have been identified. They are the NS3 antigen, NS5A and NS5B antigen. And inhibitors have been developed for these. So once you inhibit the virus from replicating, it just dies and the immune system can mop it up. So these are all the drugs that are available. I just have few more slides. And these are the drugs available in India. The one on top, Sofosbuvir, Velpatasvir combination pill, which comes as a single pill, you just take one pill a day. This is the most effective, and it just works across, there are 6 genotypes of hepatitis C. So that drug works across all genotypes, so mostly that's what we are using. In US, they have introduced 4 or 5 new drugs after this to target more difficult population, patients with renal failure, CKD patients, dialysis patients, patients with decompensated cirrhosis, patients who have developed mutation, patients who have failure to this, which happens in about 5%. Unfortunately, we still don't have them. So there are still pockets of patients we struggle, we don't know what to do. And this is why it is so good, because if you use this single pill, this is the success rate after 3 months of therapy. So it's almost 100%. Just a few percentages fail. And similarly, even in cirrhosis, which we could never treat, or decompensated cirrhosis, we're getting 80 to 90% success rate. So why is it important? If you achieve SVR, which means if you clear the virus, your chances of liver failure are almost low. Whereas if you are unable to clear the virus, this was the data from interferon, the liver keeps on going into failure. More and more people, almost 30-40% of people, will go into liver failure over a 10-year period. And similarly, HCC, if you are able to kill the virus and remove it, the incidence of HCC falls flat. If you are unable to remove the virus, the incidence of HCC also keeps rising. So that's the story with hepatitis C. You just find the C, get the RNA, treat the patient and is cured. Just a slide on vaccine. There are different ways to give hepatitis B vaccine. This is what we favor most, 0, 1, and 6 months, and almost 95% of adults will be protected. Whether to give vaccine for everyone is a debate now. Still, WHO and governments do not recommend that every person in this world has to be tested and then given vaccination because of the sheer enormity of the task and the cost that will be involved. So still we don't know, and we try to target what is called high-risk groups, patients who have a family member, patients who are exposed to healthcare a lot, people like us who work in healthcare settings, so patients on dialysis, patients who have hemophilia, who need frequent transfusions. So these are the patients officially recommended. But whenever a patient asks me, I said, if you want to do, please do. Because as an individual, you can choose to do it. But the cost effectiveness of a universal health policy where every citizen on this planet has to be vaccinated hasn't come. But children, yes, there is a universal vaccination schedule for children. I think since 2005-06, it has been quite strictly followed even in countries like India, where almost all vaccination schedules include hepatitis B. So for children, it is followed as a universal schedule, not for adults. But it's debatable. It depends on the cost involved as a government policy. So I want to end by this final slide. It's simple to eliminate hepatitis now, especially C. B is preventable and very much treatable. The challenge is to find the missing millions. That is our message today. Thank you.
One question, sir. Yeah. Regarding hepatitis B patient, the pharma people are saying that if you give a tenofovir treatment for 3 to 6 months, it will drastically reduce the viral load, HBV virus load, almost less than 500. Is it true, sir?
It is true. I showed that slide where 95% of patients will become DNA suppressed within 1 year. So even by 6 months, many of them may suppress. It is true.
So,
I practice hemato-oncology, and before any high-dose therapy or even rituximab, we screen. Now the question now is, now people are recommending to screen for anti-HBC. Slightly different question. So if you have a patient who is HBsAg negative, anti-HBs positive, and his core antibody positive, and HBDNA is also negative, what would you do? You go ahead with the high-dose therapy or you have to give entecavir?
Now the recommendations are that if it is simple immunosuppression like steroids, other types of immunosuppression or general cancer chemotherapy, just HBsAg screening is enough, and if it is negative you don't need to
No need to core antibody.
But if you are doing bone marrow transplant or rituximab or the newer biological agents which are not fully tested, then the recommendation is to do the antibody core and then give antiviral as a prevention. The reason being that you are basically altering T and B cell function, and this may be the reason why the CCC DNA in the liver is prevented from being activated. So if you manipulate that, in about 30% of patients it can reactivate. If you are using rituximab or equivalent drugs or bone marrow transplant or the newer biological agents, please check anti-HBC total. For other chemotherapy, as of now, it is not required.
And then you give parallelly the
antiviral for the duration of the therapy plus 6 months.
And you have to do total anti-HBC.
HBC total. It is called anti-HBC total. I'm glad you asked this because even in my hospital, they are not testing.
Now it has become a fashion.
Yeah, HBsAg they are not testing. So I'm glad.
We have to do it. Otherwise, we'll end up in trouble.
Because we do see the other side. Patients with activation come with liver failure.
So what is total anti-HBC? IgM and IgG? What is total?
It's mainly looking at IgG, but it comes as a single test. IgG, IgM is mixed, but IgG is predominantly tested. Separately, there is no test for IgG.
So for simple chemotherapy, we don't need?
HBsAg you need.
Oh, thank you very much. I request Dr. Arvind, HOD and Professor of Gastroenterology, to handle the certificate appreciation to Dr. Morgan.
That's it.